Welcome everyone for our 20th webinar on tire safety. I'll start with a short introduction of Indian Road Safety Campaign. Indian Road Safety Campaign is part of Salt Foundation and is working towards the mission of making Indian roads safer. Our focus is to reduce the number of deaths caused by road crashes. To achieve this, we have been working with 1,500 plus institutions and 25,000 plus volunteers across 26 states in various domains. We work in domains such as awareness, technical innovation, law, policy, medical, etc. We are working in several projects in close association with Ministry of Road Transport and Highways, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. We have also worked with State Traffic Police, United Nations, World Health Organization, etc. During this pandemic, Indian Road Safety Campaign decided to come up with a Journey to Safety webinar series. This is an effort to bring all our stakeholders of road safety on one digital platform. We have completed up until now 19 webinars, and we have covered various issues of road safety with experts from universities, healthcare, ministries, corporate institutions, and we have been having participants from different sectors and also various parts of the globe. We have had several prominent speakers in our sessions, like Dr. Eva Molnar, who's the former director of UNICE, Rashmi Udvarshi, director ARAI, Abhay Damle, former Joint Secretary, Ministry of Road Transport and Highways, and Dr. Itin Krug from WHO. Today we are going to be, today we are in our 20th webinar covering the topic tire safety. For this, I'll first of all would like to welcome our host, Mr. I.V. Rao, sir, and I'll hand over the session to you, sir, from here onwards so that you can introduce.
Thank you, Swati. Hearty welcome to our guest speaker, Mr. Sudarshan, all the participants and friends. Good afternoon. I'm very happy to host this webinar 20th in the weekly series being organized by IRSC on Road to Safety. And this particular webinar is about tire safety and its contribution to road safety. Road safety is a complex subject and needs contribution from all stakeholders to make roads safer for users. IRSC is organizing these webinars with a different set of stakeholders to understand their views and suggestions for making roads safer for users. I would briefly like to talk about various issues of general interest to set the context. United Nations had declared global plan for the decade 2011-20 of decade of action for road safety to reduce the fatal accidents by 50%, which I think could not be not possible to be achieved. So they are extending this to next decade, that is 2020-21-30. They have recommended five pillars: road safety management, safer roads and mobility, safer vehicles, safer road users, post-crash response and emergency care. If you look at the environment, I mean the changes which have happened in last decade, the Motor Vehicle Act has been modified last year with lot of improvements and also increasing the penalty for not following any of the traffic rules. Unfortunately, there is still no professional evaluation of the accident taking place every day to understand the actual reasons for the accidents. The only records we generally have are from the police complaints, which are basically made for fixing the responsibility for the accident, does not help analyzing the accident. As per the accident data available with MORTH data from 2018 indicates an increasing trend in number of accidents and also number of fatalities. In 2018, we had about 4.6 lakh accidents and 1.4 lakh fatalities. with Tamil Nadu contributing maximum number of accidents and Uttar Pradesh the number of fatalities. The big concern is the fact that 72% of the fatalities are with the mid-age group who are in the most productive phase. And 35% accidents cases involve two-wheelers and 24% cases four-wheelers, and fatalities also show the same trend. The vehicle users are still not fully aware of various features provided for driver assist for safe driving. In case of two-wheelers, the surveys indicate very low usage of the helmets, both by the drivers and the pillion drivers. And also in case of the passenger cars, the number of drivers and rear seat occupants wearing seat belts is also very, very low. When we look back over last decade, though India has considerably improved our road infrastructure, the automobiles being made almost at par with Europe, the awareness amongst the road users and post-accident emergency and treatment services have improved. But still, we do not see any reduction in accidents and fatalities, which would mean that we need to lot more and think differently. In this series, last week, we had Dr. Dhirendra, the road safety expert and trainer for defensive driving. He gave an excellent presentation about how the drivers have to be very alert and very cautious, and also preempt what is likely to happen, and also anticipate what other road users would respond to prevent accidents. Today we have with us Mr. Sudarshan from Bridgestone India, the manufacturer of all types of tires and other rubber parts. He would be talking about tire safety. When we started in Maruti in mid-80s, there were very few tire manufacturers and bias ply tires were in use. With opening of auto industry, all international vehicle manufacturers and also many more tire manufacturers have come to India. From bias ply tires, we changed to radial tires with tubes in late 90s, and then to tubeless tires, which we are using even now in 2005. With the advancement of tire designs and road infra, we have less flat tires now compared to what we used to have in the 80s and 90s. Tire, though looks like a single component, is rather a complex combination of more than 20 child parts and plays an important role in ride and handling of a vehicle. Tires, if you look at any vehicle, tires are the only contact points of vehicle with the road and play a critical and important role in controlling the motion of the vehicle, an important role in road safety. Setting the performance of tire is a complex balance of stiffness and traction parameters so as to have desired ride and handling performance. I'm sure Mr. Sudarshan will be talking much more details about these aspects. Maintaining correct condition of tires is the critical responsibility of driver, as worn out tires or improperly inflated tires can result in problem in controlling the vehicle driving and steering and increase the risk of road accidents. A poorly maintained tire may not only result in tire burst, loss of control of vehicle, but also lead to low traction and poor braking in normal driving conditions. Today, we have Mr. Sudarshan S., Senior Deputy General Manager, Bridgestone India Private Limited, Indian subsidiary of world's largest tire and rubber company. He is with Bridgestone for more than two decades, handled product development and field testing, technical service for passenger cars and truck and bus tires. He is passionate about road safety, especially on tire safety. He is Bridgestone's representative for ATMEA and ITAC. He heads the safety group of ATMA and ITAC, which works on awareness of tire safety and conducts tire care and safety campaigns across India. He is also the group leader of ITAC team, which created the exhaustive tire condition analysis guide for passenger car tires. Now I would request Mr. Sudarshan to make his presentation. Over to you, Mr. Sudarshan.
Thank you very much, Mr. Rao. So first of all, I would like to thank IRSC to take up this tire safety as one of the major point in road safety and giving me a chance to share the concern with such platform. I would start with my safety declaration. So at Bristol, we take safety as our utmost priority. And everybody in Bristol, we start our presentation with our safety declaration. So my safety declaration currently is I will follow social distancing, including while driving. So I'll maintain the distance as well. Next, please. So please let me explain a bit about Bristol. So our headquarters is in Tokyo, Japan, and we have 180 manufacturing plants and R&D facilities across the world, and 150 plus countries we have the presence. We make all types of tires, and just you can see the down picture of world's largest tire, which is 5.1 ton each and 4.2 meter high. And also tires for A380, which is the world's largest aircraft. We have some other diversified products as well. And we own the brand, tire brand like Firestone, and also the Retread brand like Bandag. We also offer mobility solutions in B2C and B2B space. Next, please. Bridgestone India was founded in 1996. Our head office is in Chakan, from where I operate. And also we have two plants, one in Chakan near Pune, and also Pithampur, which is near Indore. Next, please. So please let me highlight some of the road safety and tire safety initiatives by Bristol. To start with the Sarthi, it's a heavy motor vehicle driving program for drivers. In collaboration with CIRT, which is the Central Institute of Road Transport. It's a 45-day training. And recently we started Women Cab Driver Training Project. So left side, I'm reading about the Bristol India ones. Drishti is a vision correction camp for drivers. Now onwards, we have a plan to upgrade to complete health, not only eyes. Swavlamban is a skilling for tire fitters for tubeless tires. Not only fitting, the correct repairing as well. So we are running across India. Wheels to Road Safety, it's an education and awareness project. So these programs we are running across India. Worldwide, on the right side, you can see, we have a long running programs like Think Before You Drive and Tire Safety Campaign. So these are conducted worldwide. Recently, we launched a tire damage monitoring system. So this is like a telematics. This is a system to detect damages in tires. And this was developed in collaboration with Microsoft. So not yet in India, just launched in Europe. We are forerunners in Run Flat technology. So 1980s, we started R&D on this. So these are the tires which can run even after air loss. And you can maintain the control in case of sudden burst or blowout. Next, please. So road safety, Mr. Rao and the past speakers have already highlighted this point. India is number one in road fatalities in the world. And last few years, the number of fatalities is around 1,50,000 every year, which means around 410 deaths happen every day by road accidents. And right side, you may see many of these accidents, they are attributed to the tire or tire burst. Lastly, the economic impact. So as per UNESCAP, so Indian economy takes a hit of 3% every year due to the road accident. Next, please. So coming to the Indian tire scenario, next, please. 2009, Government of India realized the importance of tires in the road safety, and they mandated the ISI mark on tires. So basically, four categories: IS 15633 stand for passenger car, IS 15636 for commercial tires, 15627 for motorcycle tires, and 13098 is for tubes. So these four categories are required to have mandatory ISI certificate. Then coming to ATMA, ATMA, it is the Automotive Tire Manufacturers Association. So ATMA member companies are all 11 tire companies, major tire companies in India, which contribute around 95% of the tire production in India. ITTAC, ITEC is the technical arm of ATMA, and together we conduct tire care and road safety. Okay. So Bridgestone is the leader in the safety committee, and I represent Bridgestone in that. So together we have conducted a lot of technical inspections, surveys. We do have some education seminars. Also, we have some quizzes in different platforms, and also we have the tire safety pledge. Okay. Then let me speak a bit about JP Research. So JP Research does a lot of crash investigation. They have five offices across India: Coimbatore, Pune, Ahmedabad, Kolkata, and Jaipur. And their project RASI, they are doing crash research. So every office basically conduct research on different types of roads. For example, express highways, normal roads, or urban roads. So some of the data I'm using in the coming slide is coming from JP Research as well. Next, please. So this is the data from JP Research. So almost a decade. So this is 9 year data. They have conducted a survey on 4,637 cases where tire is involved. So sometimes it may be because of the tire, or tire was damaged after the accident. So any case where the tire was damaged, they had such 4,637 cases. So out of that, they found 52 accident is caused because of the tire burst, which is around 1.1%. And 1,634 cases, which is around 35% of the total cases, they were attributed like because of the accident, the tire was damaged. But a normal customer may not be able to find out the difference between whether the tire caused the accident or accident caused the tire damage. But JP Research, they have very well documented method to differentiate. So they study the marks on the road, marks on the tire, the damage type, and the damage extent. So from all this data, they can visualize whether the tire caused the accident or the tire was damaged because of the accident. Okay. Now, coming back to 1% of this accident happens because of the tire damage. So we have to study why even this 1% happened, and can it be minimized? Okay. Next, please. So Dr. Deming, he once quoted, he said, without data, you are just another person with an opinion. So as a ITEC ATMA, we decided to check. We conducted a tire inspection across India. So first three, you see, these are the normal user. So this survey was conducted on highways and normal parking, public parkings. So we can expect the normal people here. Then second category, which is a high awareness group. So basically we conducted survey in the IT companies. So we assume the IT guys are well educated ones, and they might be taking care of their cars very well, including tires. Third category was taxi customers. So because for taxi customer, the taxi and the tire, they are their livelihood. So our expectation was like, you know, these tire guys, taxi guys are taking care of their tires very well. Fourth category, we went to automobile manufacturers. So we went to two plants, and we checked the car tires there. And our assumption was like, you know, since these people are making cars, so they must be taking care of their tires very well. Okay. So let us go to the next page, which is the survey results. So what we found during these surveys, and where we checked around 30,000 tires. So left side graph, what you can see, around 35% people had the correct air pressure. Okay. In other words, 65% people don't have the correct air pressure. Okay. So In this one, we put a green color, that means good, and red color, that means, of course, danger. Okay. And orange and pink is something in between. But you can imagine this condition is only for the normal running. If you are driving at high speed or the roads are wet, weather conditions are bad, so maybe the orange one will become red and the pink one will become orange. Okay. Then looking at the right side, tread depth survey. So government has certain minimum legal tread depth. So tire has to be removed at that. So we found around 3.5% of the tires were beyond the legal limit. They shouldn't be there in the car. Okay. And there are some ways to interpret this data. Because if you think tire versus tire, good tire versus bad tire, so yes, 3.5%. But the other way to look at it is, you know, you don't need all four bad tires to make a risk. Okay? Even one bad tire can create an equally bad risk for your car. Okay, so that means this 3.5 can be up to 14 also, because even one tire, worn out tire in the car, poses the same safety risk. Next view. Then we found a lot of damaged tires in the vehicle which shouldn't be there. So the first top six pictures you might see, it doesn't look very confident, you know, this tire with bulging or cuts. So better to get it checked by some professional. And if you look at bottom three pictures, so left hand side, you see the wall, there's a lot of cracks in it. So probably when the driver, when he changed the tire to another set of tires, he didn't bother to change the valves. So the valves are very old and they have developed seasonal cracks. The center tire, it is 2006 production, so which is around 14 years old now already. And it also have a lot of sidewall cracks. Third one, there's a bend on the rim. So this rim bend may leak some, cause some air leakage. And also, if you run the vehicle like this, so it may damage the tire. So this, I'm just reading the regulation on tires. So as per CMVR, Center Motor Vehicle Rules, so chapter 5. So rule number 94, sub rule 2, it says, the pneumatic tire of a motor vehicle should be kept properly inflated and good sound condition. Okay. Rule number 94, it says, a tire shall not be deemed to be good and sound condition if, and it explains, if the non-skid depth shall not be less than 0.8 millimeter in case of two-wheelers and 1.6 millimeter in case of other motor vehicles, that means cars and trucks, below the tread wear indicator TWI embedded in the tire at the time of manufacture. So later we'll see what is the tread wear indicator or the TWI and how it is embedded in the tire at the time of manufacture. Next, please. So we'll start with the air pressure effect. How does the air pressure affect the performance of tire? So this, what you see on the screen, this is one of the tests conducted our proving ground in Europe, in Rome. So we conducted the test with the correct air pressure and low air pressure. So left side bottom picture, what you see, the car is has to take a turn along with the pylons. So what you see, the orange and white color pylons. So the car has to take a turn along with the pylon, and the left side car, what you see, is actually the car with the correct pressure, and right side car, what you see, is the car with the low air pressure. So you can see what a big difference. It's not 2%, 3% difference. There's a huge difference between the car one and car two. And same car picture, what I'm showing you from the world, bird's eye view on the right side. So actually the pylons are not clearly visible. So I just put some arrows there. So the car is supposed to take a turn along with the arrows. So you can see the car on the top, which is the car with the correct air pressure, and car at the bottom, it is a car with the low air pressure. So you can see the effect if the pressure is not correct, especially if it is low, how does it affect your car performance? You cannot drive what you want to drive. Next, please. And coming to the tread depth. So you saw in the regulation, it says 1.6 millimeter is the minimum requirement mandated by the government. And it's not only the government of India, actually across the world, such standard exists. So first of all, when it says tread wear indicator or the TWI, it has to be embedded during the manufacture of the tire. So I'll just explain, when you see the new tire, So please see the picture on the top left. So this is how the tread wear indicator looks like when the tire is new. The height of the platform, which I highlighted in the red rectangle, so that height is a 1.6 millimeter above the groove. And second picture from the top left, that is the picture of a tire it looks like when it's worn out. Okay, so you can see the tread rib wear level is same as the tread wear indicator. So the level has become same, so it is time to change the tire. You don't need to wait until the tire is completely gone. And bottom left picture, what I am showing you, it is very common in India to have the tire with irregular wear. So what I am highlighting is, even if one row of the tread wear indicator is exposed, you should change the tire. You shouldn't think like one side there is still something remaining. Okay. So actually, this is where most of the Indians says ki abhi to 10,000 aur chalega. Okay. But this is the time to change the tire. Okay. Now right side, I will show you the picture of another proving ground test. So we tested at different tread depth conditions. So the car where I highlighted with the green color arrow, that car is with the new tires. The car which I highlighted with the blue color arrow, that car is with the 5 millimeter remaining, because the new tire is around 7 to 8 millimeter. So the blue color one is with the 5 millimeter remaining tread depth. Third one is with the 3 millimeter remaining, and the first one with the red arrow, it is with the 1 millimeter tread depth. So as you can see, you know, between the yellow and red is something really dramatic happening between 3 and 1 mm. So that is the reason. So there are a lot of studies done, and they found like just after the 1.6 millimeter, the tire couldn't stop well in the wet condition. So that's why they created this regulation. And today, all the car tires or the truck tires, they have to have such tread wear indicators, which is the 1.6 millimeter of the height. And please remember, this tread wear indicator doesn't mean an indicator of a car which blinks. Okay, so they are just platform. Go to take a look. Okay. Next, please. So now we just saw some basic things about the tires, like tread wear and the air pressure. Now let us have two more case studies. These are very unique case studies because they are not mentioned in some automobile books. Okay, next, please. So if you look at the this accident case, so it looks like any other regular accident case, just normal accident case, and tire is burst, and this tire burst created this accident. So actually, the investigators they couldn't find anything. They couldn't find, you know, why this tire got burst, because there is apparently no reason why this tire got burst. There is no damage mark. Why this tire had got burst? But when it was brought to my notice, so just as a tire engineer with international experience, so it takes only few seconds to realize this is a snow tire. Okay, so the tread design, by the tread design we can make out it's a snow tire. When we investigated further, we found yes, it was a snow tire. It was a very old production snow tire. So why this guy put a snow tire? So probably because it is cheaper, and then maybe in that country the person couldn't run in snow condition, so maybe he threw or maybe he sold. Okay, so it landed up in India and somebody bought it really cheap price. Okay. Then what is a snow tire? So snow tires, they are designed to perform at minus 40 degrees Celsius. They can withstand minus 40 degrees Celsius and totally dry environment, zero humidity, they can withstand. But this tire is running on the roads which has 40 to 50 degrees Celsius and humidity maybe around 85. Okay, so you know, what else do you expect that this tire is going to perform? Okay, next case study. Next one, please. So next case study, again it looked like a just a normal another accident. Again, basically, we couldn't find why this accident happened. But if you look closely, when I point it out, you see the front tire and the rear tire. Rear tire is smaller than the front tire. Okay, I think everybody can notice it's too big difference. Okay, so actually, the front tire is the correct one. The rear tire, it is actually a smaller tire. So when we studied about all the four tires, so this front tire, which is the correct tire, which is a load index of 105, and the rear tire, which is a load index of 100. So the difference is around 125 kg per tire. So if the two tires are there in the smaller size, that means that the total capacity of the tires is 250 kg less than what it should be. And, you know, more funny thing, what we found about this accident, not only two different sizes, there were three different brands. Okay? So front two tires were of two different brands and rear two tires were of third brand. And even the, this is the SUV tire. So SUV tire have a different type, like all-terrain tire, highway terrain tire, highway luxury tire. So if, for example, you know, if you have to drive on, say, a good road and muddy road and sandy road, so then all-terrain tire helps. Okay? But if you are majorly driving on highways, so maybe it doesn't make any sense to go for the all-terrain tires. Okay? And similarly, highway terrain and highway luxury. So highway luxury is just like, you know, mainly on roads. So even though your car is like a SUV, but you are running only on roads. You are not going off-roading. You are not going on sand. In that case, that highway luxury tires are there. And let me tell thanks to Mr. Himesh. He reminded me to explain this importance of the selection of the tire. Okay. So this, again, why this guy had chosen a smaller tire, I don't know. It is the availability or it is the price. Because this 15-inch tire, both are 15-inch tire, and the smaller can also be fitted. So sometimes the driver, to save some money, actually, they put a smaller tire and nobody notices. But let me tell you, you know, one tire cost difference is 1,200 rupees. And I just calculated two tires, he saved 2,400 rupees and it cost 9 lives. So that was around 267 rupees per head. Too bad, actually. Okay. Next, please. So now we have conducted some survey with help of IRSC. And let us discuss the result of the survey. So we put 4 questions and it was a web survey. People answered the questions and we have the summary of that and we are going to discuss those summary. Okay. Next, please. Yeah, so the first survey question was, how do you know the recommended pressure for your tires? So we had 4 options. So 16% people, they said from the tire shop. 36% people said they know the correct pressure of their car from the air station at the petrol pump. So whenever they go for refill, they check with the guy. And around 50%, they said, we find it from the car owner's manual. And others, it was 0. Okay. So let us analyze this survey result one by one. First of all, from the tire shop. So let me clarify here very well. The correct air pressure for the car tire is recommended by the vehicle manufacturer. It is not recommended by the tire maker. So even if you have to swap a tire from one car to another car, so the final car where you put that tire, you have to maintain the pressure according to that car. It doesn't matter, you know, you are maintaining the pressure earlier at some other level. So this correct way is the recommended by manufacturer, not by the tire shop. Second option was petrol pump. And actually, you know, there's a limit to a human being remembering all the cars. So maybe if you ask a person, maybe he can tell the right pressure for certain car, which are very popular, sales are very high and very common to have that on roads. So maybe it's very easy. Or maybe sometimes there's a superhuman who remember all the car tire pressure. It is possible. But I personally am doing this survey for last 20 years. So whenever I go to any fuel station, I just ask this guy, you know, what is the right pressure for the car? And somehow the magic figure is 32. I don't know where is this 32 coming from. But usually when they see a car, they say 32. When they see a SUV, they say 35. So I don't know where this magic figure is coming from. So maybe when you meet with the accident, so 32 teeth break and that is how you get to the figure 32. Anyways, whatever the reason, so that is the answer. So I don't think that should be the correct way. And coming to the third one, actually, you know, there's a joke about the car owner's manual. So the joke is like, you know, if you want to hide a 2,000 rupees note from the owner of the car, you know, what is the safer place. It is more safer than putting in a locker. You put in the car owner's manual. He's not going to open it at all. Never going to open it. So that is the safest place. So many people, around 50% people said we saw the car tire pressure in the car owner manual. But let me tell you, most of the car owner manual, they don't have the recommended pressure in the car. So the correct answer for this is option D, which is 0% people have selected. So what is that option? So let us go to the next page. So this is the place which you see every day. Whenever you drive, you don't expect somebody to drive from the rear seat or the co-passenger seat. You have to drive from the driver's seat. So to sit in the driver's seat, you enter through the driver's door. Okay? You open the door and bingo, that small sticker is there which tells you about the air pressure. So you have to see there. Just maybe around 1% of the car, they don't have the air pressure sticker on the driver's side door. Where they have, in that case, just open the fuel tank lid and you will find the recommended pressure there. Next, please. Second question was, if you have to replace only two tires, where will you put these new tires? So basically, sometimes some alignment issue or something, no rotation. So we end up with two tires wearing and two tires are still left. So we don't want to replace all the four tires. We buy only four tires. Two tires. So where to put these two tires? So 34% people choose both in the front, 37% choose both in the rear, 6% choose one on the left side and one, both on the left side, as left side often whenever you are driving, the left side goes off. Okay? And then 23% people actually chose one front ride and one spare. So let me tell you option C and D. You should not go for these options because just imagine you are driving a car and the left both tire have a different, say, braking performance than the right tire. So what is happening is if you apply brakes, so say left tire have a better braking and right tires have worse braking, the car will tilt actually, so which is very dangerous. So you should never put one type of tire in one side. It is better to put one type of tire in one axle. Similarly, if you are putting one tire on spare, that is useless because you are just aging the tire, keeping in stepney. So why not you use the tire which you have spent money? Okay. So option C and D are ruled out. So which one among the option A and B is correct? So actually, the answer in two parts. One is, if you are in a country or a place where it rains very frequently, or it is a rainy season, so it is highly recommended to put both the tires in the rear. So this avoids some driving condition called oversteer. So it is good to put the new tire on the rear. But majority, if you go to a dealer or ask the opinion, majority of the people, they give you opinion, put the both tire in the front. So this opinion, actually, this is a historical opinion. And this is perfect if you are driving a bus. If you are driving a bus, I would still recommend to put the best new tires in the front. Why it is good in bus? Because in a bus, in the rear, you have two tires each. So even if one tire gets burst, another tire can still handle. Okay? But in case of front, you have only one tire each. If it gets burst, you lose the control. So this is very, very perfect true for the bus. Okay? But not so true for the trucks or the cars. In case of trucks, actually, you have two different types of front and rear. So there is hardly any option you can choose to put in front and rear because the designs are different, like rib and lug form. And also, I saw some data from the JP research. So majority of the accident where the tire burst was the case, they found it is happening when the rear tire was either completely worn out or more worn out compared to the front. Okay. So most of the cases, especially rainy season and the wet roads, rainy conditions, I would recommend to put both the new tires on the rear. Okay. Next, please. Question number three, if you have to drive non-stop continuously at high speed in expressway, what air pressure will you maintain in the tires? So first option, same as recommended by the car manufacturer, it was chosen by 22% of the respondents. Second option, 0.3 kPa, or which is a 5 psi lower than the recommended, it was chosen by 43% of the people. And 0.7 kPa, which is a 10 pond lower than recommended by car manufacturers. So together you can see 62% people choose to decrease the air pressure. Okay, while 16% they choose to have 5 psi higher than the recommended car tire pressure. So what is the true answer? Okay. So first of all, let me tell you, it is very, very scientific and logical to conclusion. When you run the car at high speed, so what happens is there is a lot of friction, tire heats up. Okay, this is true. Due to the heat, the temperature grows. So similarly, air pressure also increases. This is also true. But to conclude that because the pressure is high, I should reduce so that the finally the pressure will be correct is a wrong conclusion. Because we have conducted several tests, and what we found, if you run at high speed with a lower pressure, you are ensuring a tire burst. Okay, so here you can see 62% of the people are risking their lives, and actually this is found to be one of the major reasons of accidents which happened because of tires in Indian roads. And I want to highlight this. I put this question, I created this question, and I put for the survey. Even, you know, my brother sent me a WhatsApp message, you know, you should reduce the pressure. So I told him, you know, you tell me, you teach me anything. You teach me about engines, you teach me about plants, anything, I'm ready to listen. One thing, just one thing, that is the tire I'm handling for last 23 years. I've visited 50 different manufacturing facilities. I've driven in the proving grounds, maybe 5 different proving grounds in different continents. You know, I taught how to drive safely. So please don't teach me about tires. Everything else I am okay, perfectly okay. Every day I want to learn. This one I have tested, I've experienced, and we actually had a special test. We had a special test in our proving ground in Thailand where I was an instructor. So we had this two type of test where we have the front tire in the new tire in the front or new tire in the rear or the lower air pressure. And this is what is the experience and the data we say. Okay. So I recommend whenever you are driving on highways, never, never, never reduce the air pressure of your car. It is very dangerous. Now we are left with two options, either A or D. A says same as recommended by the car manufacturer, and D says 5 pound higher. So which one is correct? So let me tell you, if you are driving in the safe limits of what Indian highways offer, so usually it is 90 or 100, you know, depends on the highway which you are driving. So within those driving conditions, it is better to have the correct air pressure. Okay. But if you are driving in some private place, like some proving ground or some testing center, or maybe in foreign country, where you have a chance to drive higher than 160, okay, 160 or above. So it is recommended to increase the pressure. Okay, please note the word, not decrease, increase the pressure by 5 pound. Okay, and this is not my recommendation. Okay, this is written in all the standards worldwide. It is written in ITAC, ITTAC, which is the Indian standard for tires. It is written in ETRTO, which is from Europe. Also in JATMA, which is from Japan, and TRA, which is from USA. Everywhere it says, if you are running at speeds higher than 160, you have to increase the pressure by 5 pound. And it also mentioned all 4 standard. They also mention, if you are driving more than 180, you have to increase the pressure by 5 more pound, which is a 10 pound higher than what is recommended in the car owner's manual. Okay, so I request everybody, never ever reduce the air pressure. If you are driving on highways, you are driving on high speeds, never decrease the pressure. At least maintain the correct air pressure. Okay, next please. So the fourth question, I created with my experience because I also faced the same situation. So if you are driving on expressway and midway you stop for any reason, maybe for snack or something, or maybe just for fuel. So midway at air station, you notice the air pressure is higher by 0.3 kpi or 5 pound, what will you do? Okay, so 37% people, they chose do nothing, continue driving, don't inflate, don't deflate, just continue. Okay, 48%, around half of the people, they choose to correct the air pressure. So for example, OE maker says 30, and you check, it is found to be 35. So you make it 30. Okay. So 48%, around half of the respondent, they choose to correct the air pressure to what was recommended by the OE maker. And 5%, they chose to have a 10 PSI higher than what recommended by car manufacturer. And 11%, they choose to reduce by 5 PSI. So that means, again, another 60% people, they choose to decrease the pressure. Okay. Why I am saying so? Because it is very common when you are running the car, it is very common in the Indian condition, if you run the car for say 30 to 40 minutes, it is very common to increase the pressure by 3 to 5 pounds. Okay. So very logically, if you started with the correct pressure, after say 30, 40 minutes of driving or 1 hour of driving, you will have 3 to 5 PSI higher pressure. It is very common. So actually, you might have seen the advertisement, a chocolate, 5-star chocolate. It says do nothing. Sometimes it is good to, you know, do nothing. So actually, it's a good choice. Do nothing. If the pressure is by 3 pound or 5 pound higher, do nothing. Just continue. Okay. If you are actually adjusting the pressure to the correct pressure, what is recommended by the OEM, actually, you are reducing the pressure. Okay. Which is, as I told you in the earlier slide, it is dangerous. Option D, if you are reducing by 5 PSI, actually, again, you are going in, you know, danger zone, really risky. Okay. And as I explained in another slide, if you are, you know, you plan to run at high speed, like 160 and above. So it is recommended to actually increase the pressure by 10 pound. The reason is because the correct pressure, for example, was 30. And by because of the heat, it has become 35. So it has to be 40 actually to have a 5 PSI higher than the recommended. Okay. But I would like to go to next slide before concluding this slide. So this is a close-up picture of the sticker for air pressure. This actually I took from my own car. So you can see here in this you have front and rear tire pressure and two condition like a medium load, like a 3 people and some luggage, and fully load, maybe like a 5 people and fully loaded with luggage. So two different conditions and front tire and rear tire. Okay. So such a sticker is there in my car. But if you focus on the top, so top says cold tire inflation pressure. So what does it mean by cold? Actually, cold doesn't mean like a freezing cold or like a, you have to go to, you know, Shimla or Switzerland to check the pressure. Cold simply means ambient temperature. So what does ambient means? You are yet to start the journey or you just started the journey. That is a cold pressure. Actually, in ETRTO, the definition of cold pressure is also given. The definition says, if you check the pressure within 1.6 kilometer of the start of the journey, so that is a cold pressure. So you go and find out some nice air pressure shop, which is within 1.6 kilometer of your home. Okay. So that will be the cold pressure. Okay. So the earlier questionnaire, which I intentionally put it here. So better to check the pressure before running on highway or starting a long journey rather than checking midway, which will be dangerous. Okay. Next slide, please. So, we are done, and just this is a conclusion and a summary of what we discussed today. So first of all, through the tire inspection survey, we found that maintenance level is very low, and through the survey, which you just saw the report, okay, so awareness also is very low. So if people think reducing the pressure is correct, so you don't expect the right pressure. Okay, so because the number two is correct, so number one is going to be correct. Okay. So coming to point number three, we need to do a lot of things. Okay. We need to do a lot of things through the tire industry and support from the Indian government. So this is my personal recommendation. So first of all, awareness about the tire may be added to the RTO while issuing license. So for getting a license, people study. So when they study, they will read these things, they will get to know. Then information to be added in automobile engineering curriculum. Why I put this one is because some time ago, some students from, you know, very major, like one of the top institute of India, they came to me, automobile students. And I just glanced through the books they had. So it just mentioned there's a new type of tire called radial tires. Come on. You know, radial tire was invented in 1940s. In 1970s, it was there across the world. And in India, 2004, actually, it was like a tubeless and radials. They were around more than 90%. Okay. And I discussed with some of the Maruti design people. So they said, actually, we were ready to make it radial in 1985. But the Indian tire companies, they didn't have enough capacity to produce so many radial tires. So that was the reason, not because the OE didn't want it. Okay. So that is such an old thing. And the curriculum, it simply says there is a new type of tire called radial tire in the market. Okay. So I think it need a major overhaul. Okay. Then third one, tire inspection should be a checkpoint for fitness certificate. When somebody goes for fitness check, tire check should be one point. And finally, fourth recommendation is to check the condition of tire for insurance agencies while assessing the accident claims. So if that tire is found to be less than tread wear indicator, the insurance claim shouldn't be given. And maybe they can send when this new law is made, they can circulate the message, WhatsApp or SMS to everybody, like, you know, your terms and condition of insurance has changed, please read. Okay, so if your tire is found to be less than 1.6, you will not get the claim. So I think that will lead to a lot of awareness among the Indian drivers. And finally, let me just summarize. Don't wait for the government to make all these laws and all the curriculum and everything. You have to play your part. Okay, see at the bottom, play your part. Why I say play your part? Actually, P stands for pressure. Okay, please maintain the correct pressure. And we discussed a lot of things about the pressure. A stands for alignment. R stands for rotation. So alignment and rotation, please maintain as per the OE recommendation. And let me tell you, not the pressure, but alignment and rotation thing is given in the owner's manual. So please go ahead and look at the owner's manual. Maybe you can find a 2000 rupees crisp note there because your wife may have hidden it because you never open it. So go and open it. You will find it. And finally, tread, please maintain enough safe tread in your car while running. So these are my inputs or the final summary for the this session today. So with that, I end my session. Okay, thank you very much for your patient hearing. And I'm happy to take any questions on these. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sudarshan, for a very interesting explanation regarding tires and how we should maintain the conditions of tire properly. Just to respond to your mention regarding introduction of radial tires, I very clearly remember in late 80s when we wanted to introduce radial tires, one of the considerations was also the issue of vehicles going off the road very frequently because the roads were not good enough. And the tire manufacturer did mention that it will result in sidewall getting cut because of that phenomenon. That was also one of the considerations why we didn't really opt for radial tires. The other point you mentioned regarding the engineering curriculum, I think a lot needs to be done about engineering curriculum because a lot of subjects need total revival. Why only tire pressure or tires? I mean, the lot of colleges still teach about the thermodynamics engines with the carburetors, and they have not really graduated to injection system, etc. So, I mean, there are a lot of gaps between what is being taught and what are the expectations of the industry. That's another very critical area to improve our engineers' skill levels as they enter the industry. I mean, that also needs to be treated. I have one question for benefit of all the participants, actually. Each OEM has different manufacturers supplying tires for the same model. Of course, OEMs do recommend that all set of five tires should be from the same manufacturer. But different manufacturers' tires for same model, what are the problems if some customer is not able to get a replacement tire of the same make and he opts for some other make? What will happen?
So thank you very much, sir, and you very well summarized this about the curriculum. I totally agree with that. So about your question on the type of tire. So actually, what I recommend is if you have to say choose like you have five new tires of say brand X, and then by the time you need a new tire, maybe that particular brand or that tire is not available, maybe some reason or whatever reason. So you have to buy two tires. So what I recommend is that the one type of tire, the new two tires should go in one axle, either front or rear. Okay. So what happens is like when you are driving the car, so what will happen is like if you have both tire in this way, then you apply brakes, say this is good, this is not good. So the car will go like this. But if you have two new tires here and two tires here, so then it will be averaged out. Okay. So that is what is my recommendation. One type of tire go in one axle.
Yeah. Then there is some queries from participants regarding these survey results, what you have indicated, whether similar thing is applicable for two wheelers also.
Okay. So thank you very much. Actually, we did some survey on two wheelers as well. But, you know, good thing is in the two wheeler survey, we found two wheelers were maybe a bit more, I should say, the you know, probably they love their vehicles very much, or I don't know what's the reason, but the maintenance level was good. Or probably one of the reason is like, for example, if the your tire is gone, okay, so it is very difficult to manage the balance in a two wheeler. It is very difficult to manage the balance when the tire is gone, like a small tread is remaining. It's very difficult. So probably that pushes them to buy a new tire. Okay, but let me tell you, the results were better than the car tire maintenance. And also for scooter tires or motorcycle tires, I would like to say something like, you know, in case of scooter or motorcycle tires, again, the front and rear tires are a bit different. Yeah, like the tread design is different. And very good you posted this question. And this I really forward to inform you all. So in motorcycle and scooter tires, the tread is like a, what we call as a directional tires. So if you see on the sidewall, there will be an arrow on the sidewall. So when you fit the tire, you have to ensure that arrow is in the same direction as the motion of the vehicle. It should be pointing towards front. Okay. So that is, you have to make sure. So that arrow, you have to make sure that is a safety point. And since the front and rear tire designs are different, you cannot interchange. So this survey, what I shared with you, it doesn't matter much for the two wheeler tires.
One participant has inquired about the provision of using nitrogen instead of air for inflation of the tire. What is the advantage?
Okay, thank you very much. Again, very interesting question. So I have seen the brochures of you know, nitrogen makers. So it looked like magic, just like Fair and Lovely. You put on your face and next day you see air hostess and all. So truth is somewhere in between. It is good. Because when I was in Thailand, so I did a long project of 6 months on nitrogen, impact on nitrogen. So there are something which we found good and true, and something was a bit maybe exaggerated or maybe indirectly affecting, not directly. So say air leakage rate in nitrogen is lower, agreed. We tested in static condition, we tested on drum, we tested on road, and we found if you put nitrogen, it lasts longer. It was around 2 to 3 times longer compared to normal air. This is good. Number two, in school we read, you know, for say rusting, we need oxygen. So that is called oxidation. So since you put nitrogen, so rusting of the wheel and the tire component doesn't take place. Okay, that is a second advantage, and it comes in handy when, you know, truck tire you want to retread. So second life, third life, you still don't want the power to degenerate. So that is good. Somewhere it says nitrogen is cooler. So we tested and nitrogen is not cooler. Okay. But tires with nitrogen run cooler because indirectly, because the pressure is same as original, because the pressure is low, the tire will have deflection and heat up. But since the pressure is almost same as the correct, so deflection is less. So tire don't heat up. So that is the another advantage. And let me tell you, nitrogen, the FAA in USA, they mandate the use of nitrogen in all the aeroplane tires. That is because of the in case of the tire burst and catch fire, so nitrogen will not catch fire because there's no oxygen. Okay, so FAA recommends to use only nitrogen in the aeroplanes. Okay, Similarly, in F1 car and OTR also they put nitrogen. That is like a mandatory. In case of cars, it is not so mandatory, but it is good. It's good to have nitrogen in place of normal air.
And there's one more question asking about what should be the frequency of checking air inflation pressure. How often it should be checked?
Okay, great. So I don't know who you are, but let me say it's a bike or a car at least once a month, and if it's a truck, at least 15 days. The reason, the difference is like in case of truck, the pressure is like a 120, 150. So it comes out easily compared to a car, which is like a 30, 35. So we recommend to at least check it once a month. Even if you have a nitrogen, why don't you check once a month? Because the air can leak not only from the tire, it can leak from the wall, it can leak from a puncture. So it makes sense to just, and actually I would recommend, you know, just take a round through your car and just have a look at all the four tires. Maybe just do it very often. So if something is wrong, some damage is there which you don't know, you'll come to know.
Actually, this was a question from Saudagar. Actually, he also has another query. Is it recommended to fit oversized tire compared to OEM's recommendation?
Okay.
And how it will impact the car performance and the fuel economy?
Okay, so I don't know what is mean by oversize. So I hope oversize means like a wide tire. But oversized tire, if you say just literally, if you say oversize, I will not recommend. So I have a tire section here. So just imagine this is the correct size and the another tire is maybe a bigger one. So the speedometer reading, the odometer reading of your vehicle will be disturbed. So oversized tire, big no. But if you are saying the width of the tire will be bigger, and with a lower aspect ratio and maybe the ID is bigger, but OD is still same. So I would suggest you can go for it, because the wider tire with the same OD, of course, there's a law which says plus minus 3% of the OD, okay, current, the OE fitment and the new one. It should be within the plus minus 3% limit. So if you are going a proper upsize, what you call as upsize, not oversize, okay. So upsize tire gives you better braking, better handling, better cornering. It might give you worse comfort.
Fuel economy.
Fuel economy is like depends on the tread design and the pattern, but comfort wise surely, because the rubber part has come down. Okay, and also let me tell you, if you see the big vehicles like a BMW, Audi, Porsche, so they have the very big rim and a smaller sidewall. The reason is they can accommodate a bigger brake drum. Okay, so that gives you a chance to put a bigger brake drum. And comfort part, they can take care from, say, suspension itself. No need to have a comfort through the tires.
Actually, I have a doubt which I want you to clarify. At least passenger cars, I know that we are with tubeless tires. What is the situation in two-wheelers and the trucks?
Two-wheelers have also graduated to tubeless tires in many cases. So simply speaking, you might have seen there's a two type of rims. One is like an old type of rim where the spokes are there.
Yeah.
So when there's a spokes, so spokes fits on the rim, there's a hole.
Correct, correct, correct.
So that cannot be a tubeless. It's very difficult to have it tubeless. But once you have the aluminum rims.
Yeah,
you can have a tubeless. And now tubeless tires are very popular in bikes, because I have experienced once I was driving a bike and suddenly tire got punctured. It was impossible to manage the balance. It was really, really tough. You know, I almost fell. So I realized actually maintaining the balance in a bike is more difficult than a car. So it makes sense to have a tubeless tire in a bike more than a car.
What about trucks?
Pardon?
Trucks.
Okay, trucks.
Commercial vehicles.
Yeah. In commercial vehicles, commercial vehicle, let me divide into two parts, trucks and buses. So buses also, there are two types, like what we call as a city bus and intercity bus. So if you talk about intercity bus, it's almost 100% tubeless.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. But if you say city bus, maybe it's a lesser percentage, and truck is much lesser percent. Truck may be around 3% only. But intercity bus, the reason is in case of truck tires, the rim dia of the truck tire of a tubeless is 22.5 compared to a tubeless is 22 inch. So it gives you bigger distance compared to say that brake drum. It is more away from the brake drum, so that, you know, the bus, you apply a lot of brake. it makes the brake drum heat, and this brake drum heat is coming to the tire and making it burst. So because of that, internationally, the long distance buses, they run because of high speed and braking, they run almost 100% less, even in India.
Thank you. There's one more query saying that in addition to the wear indication, I mean, the whatever minimum tread depth we have to have, is there any age-wise life of a tire? I mean, is there any prescription that after so many years we have to change the tire?
Okay, great. So actually, very good question actually, and maybe I should have included already in the presentation.
This question is
not only 30 minutes and lot of things to do. It's a very good question. So basically, you know, I would say there are three conditions you need to change the tires. Number one, if the tread wear indicator is exposed, you should surely go for a tire because it is illegal to use that tire. Second one, I showed you pictures of many damages. So any damage or bulge on the tire, I would recommend to change that one. Don't wait for the TWI or age, anything. And third one, about the age. So basically, if you see a lot of season cracks, especially on the sidewall, and it is seen more if you park your car for a longer time. If you keep on running, the tire lasts long. But if you park your car for a longer time, then the cracks develop at the bottom part, which is more stressed part. So if you see a lot of cracks, we call aging cracks. So it is time to go for the new tires. And also in certain countries, I don't know, there are three places I have seen. And only three countries out of, say, around 200 countries in the world, they have some mandate. You know, one is Taiwan, I remember. Another one, some African company starting with another T. I don't remember. So these, they mandate to change the tire. The tire should not be running if it is more than 10 years from the date of manufacture. But there is no rule, though, only apart from these three countries, there is no regulation which asks you to change the tire within 10 years. But these three countries have recommendation or regulation to change the tires 10 years from the date of manufacture.
There's one very interesting question. Are the tire manufacturers taking care about the used tires which come after replacement of the new tire, or how are the old tires being end of life to protect the environment, basically?
Yes. So thank you very much once again. So
this was a question from Mr. Dinesh Koito.
Okay, so Dinesh ji, thank you very much for raising this question. So let me tell you, there's a word for it. We call ELT, end of life tire. Okay, so we are not eating that five-star chocolate doing nothing. Okay, we are doing something. So in Atma, we created a committee, an environment committee. So basically, there are four committees. We call TESS group, technology, environment, safety, and standards. So as I told you, I was head of safety. And at the same time, I'm head of the environment as well. So in the environment, actually, we conducted a survey and what is going around in India. Because we know what is going on in Europe or Australia and Japan. So actually what they have is, if somebody is coming to buy a tire, so in India, when you go to buy a new tire and you want to sell the old tire, so it sells for 100 rupees, 50 rupees, whatever. Okay. But in, say, Australia, when you go to buy a new tire and you want to throw that old tire at the shop, so you have to pay around 1000 rupees per tire extra. Okay. So there's something called Tire Stewardship Australia, which they will take 1000 rupees from you and also take the tire from you, and they will discard with that 1000 rupees, you know, very safely. But in India, nobody want to give extra 1000 rupees. And also the tire which you sell, so anything will sell only if it has any use. If there is no use, it is not going to sell. So in India, there are thousands of usages. Actually, we conducted, and actually I was the leader of that committee, which we conducted a survey across India. We conducted this survey in 30 cities, and all tire makers supported us. So it was done in 30 cities in India. And we generated a lot of data there. And we found, like, there are many use, like, retread, pyrolysis, rubber crumbs, even art, you know. Even I have created some art in my home. It's there. Okay? So there are many uses. So because of the use, we are not just throwing, just like in USA or in Europe, we are not throwing and dumping. We are using. So that's why that is not so serious concern. And also during our survey, what we found is around 15 lakh people in India they get a job because of the tires. There's an ecosystem there. Okay, so we were just trying to find out, you know, a well balance, because if we don't do anything, then maybe environment ministry is after us. But if we do something and 15 lakh people lose the job, so maybe the labor ministry not like it very much. So we have to find a balance. So we are just trying to figure out the correct situation, and maybe very soon we'll come out with a solution. But please don't think we are eating chocolate. Okay, we are doing something about it. And also, let me also tell you, government has created, like, it's in draft condition. Government has created a waste tire regulation. Something is there, and discussions are on. So maybe within a couple of years, we may see the light of the day.
So will this be part of end of life vehicle scrappage policy? What is going to come?
Yeah, actually, it's not part of end of life of vehicle. It's separately running program.
Okay.
So because end of life of the vehicle is only about the vehicle, because like, for example, if you run the vehicle for say 3 lakh kilometers, so you change maybe 3 or 4 sets of the tires. So tire disposal is much more
faster
compared to the vehicle. Yeah,
correct. The same person has asked one more question. What is your recommendation regarding retreaded tires?
Okay. So actually, as I told in the beginning, we own the brand called Bandag, which was, before we bought, it was the world's largest retread brand. And I worked in Thailand, where just next to me, both sides, there was a plant for hot retread and there was a plant for cold retread, which owned by Bridgestone. So I had a lot of experience and insight working with these guys. So what we found, actually, you know, it will be very surprising for you. If you go and do a survey on aeroplane tires, you will find 80% of the aeroplane tires are retreaded. So that means the retread technology is very, very good if done by good method. So for example, Bridgestone has the retread plant. So tires from aeroplane tires from India go to Japan plant, get retread and come back. Okay. So if you do like that, the tire is almost like new. But if you go to some roadside retread guy, so maybe it is not so great. So what we found internationally is, for commercial vehicle, retread is running very well. And in many countries, people are taking 5 or 6 retread. But in India, we have like a lesser retread. If you find a good brand and good way of doing retread, it is okay. But I don't still recommend for passenger cars, because the cars are running at high speed and the safety is at risk. Even for buses, in China and USA, I saw the regulation. It says retread tire should not go in the front. It can be there on the rear, but should not go in the front. So only buses, not trucks. So such regulation exists. I didn't see actually regulation in India.
The wheel assembly needs to be rebalanced. Will it impact the balancing of the tire assembly?
Okay, so basically when we do the retread, so actually tire becomes a bit heavy. The whole part becomes heavy, not the one part. But where there's a joint, if you are doing the cold retread, there's a joint there. So joint part typically has a heavier weight. So you have to do it, you know, you have to fit it again. So you have to do the balancing again.
There is another question. If the vehicle is not being used regularly, any precautions for protecting the tire? What needs to be done for non-usage of vehicle?
Yes. Thank you very much. So this lockdown maybe has created this question. And even in some IT guys, I see, you know, they get a project 6 months, they go out USA, come out after 6 months. Very simple. And let me tell you, many OEMs also do it. I've seen Maruti doing it. So what they do, because like say Maruti is exporting vehicles, so maybe another 10 days or something after manufacture, the vehicle is parked on say the truck or the ship for maybe 2 weeks or 3 weeks. So what they do, they increase the inflation by 10 PSI. Yeah, inflate it a bit. So because as I told you, when the tire is at the lower part, you know, it is deflected. So this deflection causes a crack. Okay. So if you are like say it's about say 15 days to 1 month, I would recommend increase the pressure by 5 PSI. But if it is more than that, I would recommend to have more around 10 PSI more. Okay. So this will also, there is something called flat spot. So if the vehicle is stationary at long period at this spot, so this temporarily get deflected, temporarily. So when you start running after say 1 month or 2 months, just like a lockdown, you will feel the bump. But after say 150 kilometers, around 100 or 200 kilometers, depending on your speed and usage, it will disappear. Okay. But if you know this is going to be like this, so why don't you increase the pressure? And second way is, if it is possible, you know, you change the car position, you move it. So I have seen one of the guy, Mr. Akhilesh, he is in the audience. I just saw him. So what he did, I saw him doing it. So in his car tire, he marked with a white chalk. Okay. So when he's moving, he makes sure this chalk mark is here. Second time he marked like this. So by rotating, he ensure each part get enough load. I think it's an intelligent way. So tire, I'm still learning. I don't say I don't learn something new. I still learn such great guys.
There's another question regarding environmental issue. When a vehicle is used on road, in addition to the tailpipe emissions, tires use also results in carbon black pollution as tire wears. So are the tire manufacturers doing anything about this?
Yeah, so actually, internationally, there is a, I don't have the name now, but on. So they have initiated this project, and they're along with ETRTO and ETRMA. Okay, so that is the European Tire and Rubber Manufacturer Association, and a very dynamic leader, Ms. Fazilet. So I met her personally. She is very passionate about this project, and she's pushing the tire companies to, you know, study deeply. First of all, we are studying it deeply, and comes under the microplastic range. So once the study is over, we know the impact, and then of course we already have to do something about it. Yeah. So one thing is about, say, instead of carbon, we may increase the, say, silica. Okay. So silica actually is heavier, and it settles on the road rather than, you know, just like a carbon flying away.
There's a query regarding, is there any way one can have the tire pressure indicated on the dashboard?
Okay. Yeah. So I think it's your day today. I have seen some wall caps, okay, wall caps on the wall. So some innovator from Gujarat, they have created a wall cap. So if the pressure is correct, so that they come in different ranges. Okay, for example, the wall cap may be like a 35 psi, 38 psi, 40 psi. You can choose the correct wall for as per your car. You put on your tire. So if the pressure is correct, the top will be green color. And if it is slightly low, it will change the color to yellow. And if it is really low, it will change color to red. So just take a round and you will know. Okay, so such wall cap is available thanks to the entrepreneurship of Indian industry. So such thing is available. You can just maybe Google it and you will find it. Made in India is also available.
I think in Europe there is also a regulation for monitoring their tire pressures. So they get the indication of the tire pressure.
Yeah, actually, the TPMS is mandatory in many countries, and from 1st October, actually, that will be mandatory in India as well. So there will be a TPMS in every car. Every new car sold should have a TPMS. This draft has already notified, and from 1st October 2020, this will be applicable.
There is a question regarding, is there any technology that tire will change color due to aging?
Actually, rather than technology, I would like to say, you know, in the old days, it was very common. So when the tire was old, or, you know, it changed color from black to, you know, different color, like a bluish tint. But at this moment, we have actually created what we call as a long black tire, so which looks black for a longer time. But yes, maybe I'm not sure, but very soon, maybe somebody will come up with some technology, like when the tread, it going up to the tread wear indicator, it will change the color. Maybe I'm not very sure what stage of R&D people are there, but maybe they will come up with some color changing compound or something. Okay. So right now, when people try to put some chip or something, it acts like a foreign material. So it creates a separation. At this moment, this is a limitation. So maybe soon there will be a new technology. We don't know.
There's a query regarding which tire, that is, whether with tube or without tube, which is safer? Which is more safe?
Safe.
Tube or tubeless?
Yeah. So tubeless tire is more safer. So we have a lot of data, we have a lot of results. So tubeless is safer. The reason is in case of a puncture, in case of tube type, air can be lost within 4 to 5 minutes. In case of tubeless, sometimes we see actually that you keep on filling every 1 month and it can last up to years actually. So air loss rate is very, very low in tubeless. And that is the reason most of the countries, developed countries, they use almost 100% radials in car tires, truck and bus tires. It's almost 100% tubeless. This is the reason, air loss. Second one I explained, in truck and bus, the rim dia is bigger, which gives you better cooling and better running. So those are the tubeless tires are more safer for long distance, high speed running.
Is government coming out with any regulation about the carbon black pollution from tires?
Actually,
at least I have not heard anything like that.
Yeah. So actually, a year ago or a couple of years ago, our transport minister, he said something about switching to silica, but somehow it didn't go forward. I don't know what is the background. So maybe the Indian tire makers or the tire makers in India, they don't have enough capability or maybe the raw material availability. I don't know. He did speak about that in the parliament, but after that, nothing much happened. Few meetings happened, but then it fizzled out. So maybe some technology wise or raw material availability wise, there are some issues. So it may take some time.
Will there be any change in tires for electric vehicles?
Again, interesting question. So basically think about an electric car or electric scooter or electric bus. Okay, just think. So what is electric bus? Normally electric bus is, they just remove the engine and put battery. Okay, same for the car, same for the bikes. So because basically the vehicle is same, so tire is basically same. Okay, I'm not finished yet, but let me tell, there are some new innovation. For example, I saw one a French company, they come up with a totally new vehicle. For example, a bus which had only 4 tires, not 6 tires. Okay, and all the 4 tires were steerable, and battery can be fitted at the bottom and the top. So there's a very, very special unique technology. And the tires, if you see the vehicle, no, tires were at the extreme, this way also extreme, this way and this way also extreme, all the extremes the tire were placed, not at the midway. So that type of course, you need a different type of tire, like super single tires. Instead of 2 tires, there's a 1 single tire. So those type of technology. And also at the same time, you know, what is the problem with the electric vehicle? So let me tell you from the tire point of view, there are 3 problems for us as a tire maker. Number one, electric vehicle don't make any noise. So because normal vehicle makes noise, so you don't hear the tire noise. But in electrical vehicle, only noise is the tire noise. Okay, that is one. Number two, electric vehicle, because of the battery, it is heavier. Okay. Number three, electric vehicle, because of the electric motor, there's a huge torque. Okay. So suddenly there's an acceleration and suddenly there's a brake. So that torque creates a special type of wear, commonly we call heel and toe wear. So we have to come up with a design which can carry more load, which noise sound level is less, and which this type of wear is less. And at the same time, Bridgestone is leader in that technology. We call like you might have heard something called low rolling resistance tire, but we are working what we call as a ultra low rolling resistance tire. So just to give you an idea, Government of India is trying to come up with some regulation called AIS 142. So AIS 142 is about environment. So it covers 3 things, rolling resistance, wet grip and noise. So rolling resistance for truck tires, what they have set is 8.5. Okay, so this is going to be a regulation, okay, not yet. And the limit is 8.5 or below. And let me tell you, we already have a tire in Europe, which is around 4. So you can imagine, you know, the regulation, and actually this regulation, which was supposed to come in 2020 and was to update in 2025, which was around 6.5. So by this ratio, we are actually having the tire, which is needed maybe 2050 or 2070. Okay, that tire is already we have. So this tire can extend the single charge running by 10 to 20%. Okay? So that is the ultra low rolling resistance tire.
Can I take one more question?
Yeah, please. I am perfect. Please go ahead.
Okay, thank you. What is the ideal life of tire, which I think partially answered, and why doesn't the manufacturers provide a buyback or retrofit options as part of circular economy? And what is the requirement for high speed tires?
I'm not able to guess this question. Can I read? So where is this question? Who's the?
This is from Pinaki Dasgupta. He has posted at 5:24.
Okay, so it's just come 5:26. What is the ideal life of tires and why doesn't the manufacturer provide a buyback or retrofit option as a part of circular economy? What's the requirement of high speed tire like nitrogen fuel? Okay, great. So Pinaki, thank you very much. And first of all, ideal tire life, there is no such ideal tire life, because I can share my experience. So we did some survey, we called OE mileage survey. So what, I'll just give you one example. So one particular car model, which is common across India. So just in 1 year, we test across India and we have a result. So average tire life in Shimla was say 20,000 kilometer, and the same tire, same model was giving 50,000 in Delhi and 1,50,000 in Ahmedabad. So, you know, what's the difference? So I don't know, like Ahmedabad, maybe people are very, very cool. They're not aggressive drivers, you know, same as their normal life. Delhi, I was in Delhi, you know, I drove like crazy and every red light was like a, you know, just like a F1 race track. So sudden brake, quick acceleration. And then Shimla, if you go to Shimla, the vehicle, when it is going up, you know, the front tire has to generate a lot of traction. Then while come down, you have to generate braking. And then lots of right and left turns are there. So that gives a excessive force. So just the tire which runs, the exactly same tire which runs 1,50,000 in Gujarat, runs only 20,000 in Shimla. So there's like, it's not 10% difference, 5% difference, it's a 500% difference or 700% difference. So that's why you do not say any ideal life. And same goes for truck. One truck may be carrying cotton, another may be carrying steel, and some is going uphill, downhill, and windy roads. So they just like a fuel efficiency, the car has a fuel efficiency, but every driver doesn't get the same fuel efficiency. Similarly, every driver don't get the same life of the tire. Then about the circular economy. So as I said, government is drafted something, and when it comes into regulation, maybe that waste tire disposal regulation or something. So then yes, it's a part of circular economy. The companies will have to buy back the tire when selling the one. But the challenge is like in, as I said, in say Australia, they charge 1,000 rupees extra from the customer. So if our Indian customer ready to pay that rather than getting 200 rupees, he has to pay 1,000 rupees. So it's a loss of 1,200 rupees per tire. So those are some challenges, and also what to do with those tires are still some challenges. But yes, we are on our way. We are discussing, and maybe within a couple of years, there may be some law regarding that.
Thank you, Mr. Sudarshan, for your excellent presentation and very patiently answering all the questions which have come on the chat box. Thank you very much. It is a very learning experience even for me. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, everybody, including Swati and you know, because first time I realized tire is also part of safety, what we saw in the presentation and what we found, the awareness level. So I think this such seminar is really helpful for you know, even interacting for me is a new learning, what people are asking and what they want to know. It's a new learning for me. So thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. And it was very nice to see Mr. Rao. So it's sort of my idol. I used to see.
Oh my God.
No. So today, thank just face to face, just in front. So that is one of the amazing opportunity for me. So thank you very much, everybody. Thanks thank a lot you. For all thank the participants as well.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Sudarshan, sir, for attending the session. Thank you, participants. I'll see you guys again for our next session. And until then, have a nice day.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Bye.